Like Let us pray. Most gracious and heavenly Father, we come first and foremost just telling you thank you. We thank you for your son Jesus, for what he's done when he died on the cross for all of us. But he didn't stay dead. He got up early that Sunday morning with all power in his hand, so that we may have life and have it more abundantly. Now, Father, we come to you asking that you touch this family. Father God, we know your words say weeping may endure for a night, but joy comes in the morning. Father God, we know they may ask questions and say, Lord, when is my morning coming? But Father, give them the assurance that their morning is on the way. Father God, right now, when they have those sleepless nights and they begin to take a trip down memory lane and tears begin to flow down their eyes, let them know that you will wipe every tear. Father God, you said in your word that you will not leave us comfortless. So we ask that you comfort them right now. Father God, you said in your promise that you'll never leave us nor forsake us. You said that you will be with us until the end of times. So, Father God, we ask that you be with them when the dust settles and everybody go home. when the weeks pass, the months pass, and the years pass, you be there to comfort them. Now, God, I ask that you touch a mother. Lift her up right now where she's torn down. Mend that broken heart. Father God, we ask that you touch her sister. Father God, let her know that you're still right there. Now, God, we ask that you touch her children. They may be asking questions and don't understand right now. But by and by, when the morning comes, they'll understand it better. Because you said in your word that you will give us peace that surpasses all understanding. So God, we ask that you touch them right now. Give them strength. Give them courage. Let them know that they will see their mother again. She will see her daughter again. She will see her sister again. Let the family know they'll see their niece, their cousin again on the other side when the trumpet sounds. Whew, Jesus, you said in your word today, Father God, be with them. And Father God, we'll be so careful to give you all the praise and to give you the glory. Because God, we know you don't make no mistakes. So we ask all of this in your son Jesus' name. Let all God's children say amen.
Hallelujah, saints. Our Old Testament scripture reading this morning comes from the book of Psalms, chapter 23, and it reads, "The Lord is my shepherd. I shall not want. He maketh me to lie down in green pastures. He leadeth me beside the still waters. He restoreth my soul. He leadeth me in the path of righteousness for his name's sake. Yea, though I walk through the valley of the shadow of death, I will fear no evil. For thou art with me, thy rod and thy staff, they comfort me. Thou preparest a table before me in the presence of mine enemies. Thou anointest my head with oil, my cup runneth over. Surely..." "Surely goodness and mercy shall follow me all the days of my life, and I will dwell in the house of the Lord forever." God bless you, family.
New Testament reading comes from 2 Timothy 4, chapter 6 through the 8th verse. "For I am now ready to be offered, and the time of my departure is at hand. I have fought a good fight. I have finished my course. I have kept the faith. Henceforth, there is laid up for me a crown of righteousness, which the Lord, the righteous judge, shall give me at that day. And not only to me only, but unto all them also that love his appearing." Thank you for the reading of God's word.
Thank
Hallelujah. Glory to God. Thank you, First Baptist Church Choir. You gonna do one more? Awesome. Praise God. Hallelujah. Once again, thank you, First Baptist Church Choir, for both of those beautiful selections. To God be the glory. To God be the glory. You know, Debbie loved her church family. She loved her pastor, and she loved the First Baptist Church Choir as well.
And Debbie was also a very gifted singer as well. So the second point, a life lesson that Debbie left us, and it's been reinforced by the choir, and that is family, friends, co-workers, church family, is to have faith and to rejoice and be grateful. That was the second plaque that she had on her wall. So it's a reminder to all of us, irregardless of what we might be experiencing, and our hearts are heavy. And yes, it's difficult to let my niece and your mother, your sister, your daughter make that transition to the heavenly home. But she reminded us to have faith and to rejoice and be grateful. So we're grateful that God blessed us to have Debbie for 60 plus years, aren't we? We're grateful. Hallelujah. So at this time, we'll have acknowledgments and resolution by Dr. Tracy McClinton. Followed by her, we will have reflection. As a family, Stephanie Dawson, Debbie's first cousin. As a friend, Tammet Floyd Wade, her bestie, her best friend. And as a co-worker, we'll have Cheryl Bolin from TOA. She's a TOA site manager. So please come in that order. So at this time, we have Dr. Tracy McClinton with acknowledgement and resolution, followed by the reflections.
Good afternoon. Glory to God. Resolution. March 23rd, 2024, you are not alone in your hour of pain. Our Father sees from his throne above to soothe and protect you with his love. He leaves you not when the storm is high. You are safe, for he is always near. Oh, rest in his peace, for the Lord cares. We're sending words of comfort to the family from the pastor and members of Miracle Revival Tabernacle, where Debbie's mother, Hattie Hale, is a dedicated member. For the word of God says, whosoever live and believeth in him shall never die. For if we believe that Jesus died and rose from the dead, even them that sleep will rise also. We encourage you to lean on God's word the more, for his word is truth and life. Family, it is well, though deep and sore is the heart, is the hurt, the hand that wounds knows how to bind and heal the broken heart. It is well, God's ways are always right, and his perfect love is over you, though far above our sight. Keep the Lord close to you, for he always comes to claim his own. Humbly submitted, Miracle Revival Tabernacle, Gibson, Tennessee, Joe N. Johnson. First Baptist, Murfreesboro, March 23rd, 2024. Blessed are they that mourn, for they shall be comforted. Matthew 5 and 4. A writer once stated, the will of God will not take you where the grace of God cannot keep you. It is in these difficult moments of life that we see the gracious hands of God under us in support, over us in shelter, around us in protection, behind us in motivation, and before us in direction. We soon realize that though it feels lonely, we're never alone. And the God that meets us in the darkness escorts us to the dawn. May the God of everlasting comfort bring consolation to your heart in this hour of bereavement. Remember that our God will never leave or forsake you, but will guide you into a place of peace according to God's will. Don't lose heart as those that have no hope, but remember that this interlude of human mortality is hurriedly given way to a greater and eternal homecoming. Therefore, we, the First Baptist Church family, express our deep thoughts of love, compassion, and sympathy to the family and beloved friends of Debbie Mays. In this season of sorrow, it is our sincere confidence that as Debbie, a faithful wife, mother, grandmother, sister, and friend, and cousin, exhibiting love for others, diligent service in the church and community, be it resolved that Debbie Elaine Hale Mays is at peace, free from the troubles of this life, and resting in the hands of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ until we shall meet her again in heaven. Humbly submitted, the First Baptist Church family, Reverend James M. McCarroll, Jr., pastor, Sister Arlene Mitchell, church clerk. Acknowledgements. The family would like to thank the staff of J.C. Hellum Funeral Home, the doctors and staff of Ascension, St. Thomas West, and Rutherford Hospital. Thanks to all the family and friends for their kind words, heartfelt sympathy, love, and support. Please continue to lift us up in prayer during this difficult time. Thanks to the church family and First Baptist Church, Murfreesboro, Tennessee, and Pastor James McCarroll. Thank you.
Thank you. It is my absolute honor to be asked to provide reflections on behalf of our family. My name is Stephanie Dawson, and I am Debbie's first cousin. Each of us is given a divine path and divine gifts for our lifetime. This is God's promise. We will be cared for and protected for every step of the way. This too is God's promise. When we have fulfilled our earthly journey, our spirit and legacy will continue for eternity. This too is God's promise. Debbie has fulfilled her journey, and today we celebrate her life, legacy, and spirit. Daughter, sister, mother, grandmother, wife, friend, aunt, cousin, cosmetologist, entrepreneur, teacher, child of God. These are all roles and gifts Debbie fulfilled along her journey. I have very fond memories of Debbie because she was my cousin, but as you heard mentioned earlier, we have a large family with a very large age span, and so in many ways, she was also my aunt. And I also had the pleasure of living very close by to her. Growing up, some of my fondest memories are going to her salon in the town of Milan, where she was a cosmetologist and an entrepreneur. She was a young, black, vibrant woman who wanted to serve her community and bring beauty, joy, and love to all. Her salon was a place of life where people came, they got dolled up, and they told lots of good stories and lots of jokes. She also gave me four beautiful cousins, and we have lots of good memories all throughout our lifetime, and that was a gift that she gave to me. I also got to see her as she continued along in her life and developed a passion for teaching and helping others, and she was dedicated to showing our youth a path forward. These are just a few of many memories that I have of Debbie. But what I will remember the most is her witty sarcasm. And if you knew Debbie, she had some witty sarcasm, that's for sure. Her infectious smile and her pure heart. And so today, we have one responsibility, and that is to celebrate Debbie and the impact she left on each of our lives. We will cry together. We will tell funny stories. We will prepare to move forward, holding her forever in our hearts. That is our duty. In closing, I want us to be reminded of John 3:16. For God so loved the world that he gave his only son, that whoever believes in him shall not perish, but have eternal life. This is God's promise to each of us. This is God's promise to Debbie. Thank you.
Her child, so will I comfort you, and you will be comforted, says the Lord, Isaiah 66:13. A friend is your buddy, your pal, your amigo, your comrade. You know someone you trust and like enough to hang out with on a regular basis. Supportive, loyalty, honesty, empathy, respect, trustworthy, non-judgmental, dependable. These are all the words that describe my friend. It was a blessing to have her in my life. The years she's been in my life, I don't even know when we started, but she's just been a part of my life, all of my life. It was so hard to receive the news last Sunday, because my plans was to come here to stay for her. But God had plans for her in a different way. When I first found out Debbie was in the hospital, I'm a numbers person. There's six of us and four of us are born on the 23rd of the month, which is 2 and 3 is 5. So the first day I saw was February 23rd. The last time I saw her was March the 5th on my dad's birthday. I never did say anything to Carolyn. You know, it was like I get to hang out with my girlfriend on my dad's birthday. And that day, I left out of the room, cried a little bit, and Carolyn said, "Everything's going to be all right." And I said, "Yeah, I'm trusting. But in my heart, I felt like that was going to be the last time that I would get to see her. And if you know David, she would always grab you, kind of by the chin, and kiss you on your forehead. So this day, I just grabbed her. That's the way she put me in. I kissed her on her forehead. She was trying to talk. I was like, "Don't talk." She said, "I'm going to talk to you." Best yes and no. We'll do the talking today. And she rested, and I prayed. And I went back and forth all this time ever since last Sunday. And you have questions. Okay to question, you just have to be able to receive those answers. And I said, I just wouldn't imagine being here and not being able to pick up the phone and call her. Or when I would come to Murfreesboro, I would go to 2323 was her address to see her and hang out. And every time I would come to Murfreesboro, we would have lunch. And I just realized today when I went to the funeral home that the daycare that I went to see was right behind, the funeral home was right behind the daycare. And I was like, wow, never knew all of this was in the same area. But I want to say to Carolyn, great job as a sister, always have. And I watched you, got to watch you on the field just take care of Debbie, just like, you know, she was yours. And Mother Hale, thank you for always being there. Thank you for being the woman that you are, the woman of God that you are, and for raising us and making sure that we were always ladylike and presented the right way we needed to be presented. A lot of times we were often looked at as we were better. We weren't better. We were just raised in a way to present ourselves the way we should be presented in public, to always seek God first, to carry God with us, to trust God, to act right, even though we want to act wrong sometimes, but you know, when you raise, you act right, because it comes back. And to her children, y'all know I love you. Whatever, I'm here for you. Whatever you need, you know you had an awesome mom. She spoiled you all, and that's okay, but we got you. And I just wanted to say, you know, I appreciate you all having given me the opportunity to share. Jerome, I appreciate you giving me the opportunity to have a few minutes ahead with her at the funeral home. I is still just trying to register. Being with someone and not being able to see them, but I know God is able, and I know he can heal her. And I know he gives you the strength that we need. I know this. I just want to say again, I thank you. I thank God for allowing us to have the friendship we had. And I was talking to my sister earlier, and we was talking about a friend. You know, a friend is different than a sister or a brother or the community. The friend is like the buffer in between. The friend can always talk about things you have never talked about, but just say, or you won't even mention in the community or other associates. That friend is like that buffer. You just always know that you have that person to lean and depend on. So cherish your friendship and just be grateful for the friends that you have. If you have a bestie, that's what she called me, her bestie. And we were cut up. So today I'm gonna act right, because Sister Hill, you know, you better act right. I said, I'm going to act right. She got us kicked over there. But you know, when you can see a mother, I'm used to it. When you can see a mother give God praise and shout, that was Debbie. That's how we know, is to praise God in spite of, because he don't make mistakes. Even though we sometimes think he does not make mistakes. And I'm going to end with this. We were at school at Austin Peay. Yeah, we went to school together too. We did everything together. And one night, I always like to go to bed with music. And Debbie, if you knew Debbie, it's like, she gonna have her way. And I said, she said, I'm trying to go to sleep and have class early in the morning. You don't have early morning class. I said, well, the music's not that loud. She said, well, it's too loud for me, because I can't go to sleep. And I said, well, just turn over and put the pillow up your head. And get that up. She didn't say another word. She went over there, and I love Charlie, Uncle Charlie Wilson. Yeah, Yearning for Your Love was the song I was listening to in class. With an 8-track, okay? An 8-track. He went over there, snatched that 8-track cassette out of that player, raised up the window, and I room faced the football field. And when I said she chunked, she didn't throw, she chunked. I said, you just country. She just threw it out the window. She said, well, now you can't listen to Charlie or nobody else. And I was just thinking about that, and I said, Lord, have mercy. I said, you know, we've had so many memories. And when we last went on the cruise together, she said, you got your bathing suit? I said, I said, you got yours? She said, I said, I got me a two-piece. She said, I do too. I said, you do? She said, Rolanda done hooked me up. She had all these bathing suits. I said, Debbie, I was telling my other girlfriend that. I said, you gonna wear that? She said, girl, we on a cruise. What happened on a cruise? Stay on the cruise. And I just want to end with this book right here I keep at my work site, wherever I go. And I have to travel a lot, so I take this with me. It says, Prayers for Women of Faith. It says to Tammy, someone who I love with all my heart and soul, you continue to seek the Lord, and he will give you all the desires of your heart. I hope this book will lift you when you're down and make you smile when you want to cry. May God bless you. Debbie, May 5th, 2001.
And Debbie actually sat right outside of my door by my office. I'm not a public speaker, so bear with me. I'll do the very best I can. I just want to put up family. I'm so humbled by the invitation to speak today. It was very unexpected, but Debbie was someone who was very special to me and to all of our Teo family. I've tried to find the right words to honor Debbie, and I truly don't think that I found any that are adequate. She had no idea how much she touched the lives of others, but she was impactful to me. Debbie is part of our TOA family. A family is defined as any of various social units differing from, but regarded as equivalent to, the traditional family. In our family, Debbie is known as Miss Debbie. She was not only a valuable member of the TOA team, she was also very loved by physicians, leadership, staff, patients, and myself. Debbie's homecoming was unexpected and seemed surreal to myself and so many others. I still struggle with the fact that she would no longer be present each day. Miss Debbie had the most vibrant soul and such a beautiful smile. She was not loud or boisterous, but she was still a force nonetheless. The announcement of her homegoing rocked our TOA family. I heard many stories this week about Miss Debbie. She was a mentor to those who needed her guidance, and she was a friend to all. Her laughter and smile is what was most mentioned this week, and I've heard it mentioned quite a few times here today as well. She did not care about your title or your standing. She treated everyone the same. There were days that I would hear her interactions with patients and walk out of my office because someone was being very rude, only to find her laughing. She would say, "Some of our patients are crazy." And then she would tell me about the interaction with the patient that had just left. She was never malicious or unkind. She was generous and kind-hearted, and we should all take a page out of her book when it comes to kindness and grace. Our TOA patients loved Miss Debbie. She would stand in line, or they would stand in line and wait for her to check them out because she was their favorite, and we have very long lines. She was always gentle and kind and gave everyone the same amount of time and attention. She had a way of making everyone she came into contact with feel special. She could handle the most difficult of patients with grace, and they would walk away from her desk with a better attitude, and most of them with a smile on her face. I never heard an unkind word from Debbie. There have been days when I would be upset because of one thing or another, and she would just smile at me and tell me that people would be people and we needed to love them all, which sometimes is very hard. Debbie loved her family and her grandchildren. She was always telling stories about them and making us laugh. She would say, "This is one of her best. The girls and I are going to Mama's this weekend." And we'd say, "Oh, really? Well, you better be careful when you drive. And don't spoil those girls too much." And she'd say, "I don't spoil those girls. That's my mama." We all knew who did the spoiling, right? Debbie, on the front of her car, she has a license plate that says Gigi. And my boys, I have two teenage boys, and we were walking in one day, they were coming to work, I don't know, remember why, but they had to come to work with me for a few minutes. And they said, "What is a Gigi?" And I said, "Well, I think that's Gigi, and that's Miss Debbie." They said, "Miss Debbie, this sits outside your door." And I'm like, "Yes." So when they walked in, they looked at her, and they said, "What's a Gigi?" And she said, "That's Gigi, and it means grandmother." And I said, "Oh, really?" And she said, "Yeah, grandmother. I have two little granddaughters." And she proceeded to tell them all about her granddaughters. So from that point forward, every time they would come into the office, they would look at her and say, "Hi, Gigi." When I had to share the news of Debbie's passing, they were truly devastated. They loved her dearly. In 2015, Debbie was my unofficial person. She was my my go-to. Her desk was located the closest to my office, and she knew my schedule many days more than I knew my schedule. I could count on her good morning and her smile to start my day. I will miss her so very much, and it is hard for me to accept that she will no longer be here. I do not have the words to express how much Debbie will be missed. I will miss her conversations, the music she played each day, and her ability to turn a difficult situation into something positive. I am so very sad about her ongoing and will miss her terribly. I am thankful that God blessed me with knowing Debbie. She made a positive impact on my life, and heaven gained another angel, and I am sure she is singing her angel song this morning in her beautiful smile. I would like to express not only my thanks, but the thanks of the physicians and senior leadership at TOA for allowing us to honor and be a part of Debbie's homecoming celebration. She was very loved and will be forever missed by all of us. She has left a very large hole that we can never fill. Thank you very much.
Thank everyone for those wonderful reflections. And we know that the memories are something that we will hold on to for a lifetime. And in our family, we are a strong believer that although we're going to miss our loved one, Debbie will never be forgotten because she left an incredible legacy. And we are also a family that believes, a family that prays together, stays together. And we have celebrated 53 reunion, and this year will be our 54th reunion. And I just want to mention that the other three life lessons, the third one actually happened at a reunion. So shortly after the pandemic, we were all wanting to come together. And we decided in 2021, we were going to bring the family together. And we decided our theme was going to be stronger together. Because we believe that coming together would be powerful. And I want to acknowledge that my two nephews, Jerome and Lamont, said, because we were debating, should we even come together? But Debbie's oldest son stepped forward along with Monty and said, Maurice, that we're going to have a reunion. And we came together, and our theme was Stronger Together. And we were all taking this beautiful photo, and we were just standing there. And Debbie did this. She did her arm like this. So she said, let's all of us do this. So the whole family started doing this, and it signifies Stronger Together. So I want to say to the family, when you see that emoji, that Stronger Together emoji, it represents Debbie because she recognized that it was powerful. We're more powerful together versus individually. And then lastly, the last 2 points, she said, pray big, worry small. And then lastly, laugh more and stress less. And her proudest achievement, her 4 beautiful children, and her 2 beautiful grandchildren. And so at this time, we're going to have a tribute to Mama by her son, James Jerome Scott, followed by a tribute to Mama, her daughter, her oldest daughter, Chastity Renee Nicole Rice. And then we're going to have a final selection by Kristen Anderson, and then we're going to have the Word of God by Pastor James McCarra.
Good morning. So what I'm, anybody that knows me, well, first I just want to say thank you, everyone. Thank all of y'all, family, friends, every single person. You guys have really showed a lot of support. So, I have a tribute. Anybody that knows me knows that I love poems and I love quotes. So I found a poem online, and it really described everything to the T. I didn't even have to look long. It's like it just popped up out of nowhere. So I want to read this. So I have two versions of the poem. The first one is just the general poem itself. Secondly, is my variation of the poem and my words. So first it says, there's a very special bond between a mother and her son, a closeness which grows deeper through the years. It's marked by tender moments, crazy antics, quiet talks, and strengthens as they share their hopes and fears. It forms and it develops very early on in life. When he's unsure, but she says, yes, you can. The bond remains unbroken, growing even stronger still until her little boy becomes a man. Then, as they both grow older, little things begin to change, and she learns she can rely upon her son. Life completes its circle, though at times to her is strange, for just yesterday he was her girl. I've always said that, you know, they say we always got looked at wrong because they all, you know, bad temptations for mama's boys and stuff like that. There ain't nothing wrong with it. I always say I realized with my daughter that the bond between the daddy and the little girl is so strong, whereas the same thing with the mother and her son. It just hits different. So this one, the first one was called A Mother and Son. This one was called Debbie and Bookie. Anybody didn't know, that's what she called her. So there is a very special bond between me and my mom, a closeness which grew since the day you held me in your hands. We have so many memories, crazy moments, and just quiet talks just between me and mom, just between mama and Bookie. And strengthened as you have instilled hope and positivity into my life. It formed and developed very early in life, starting when it was just me and you. When I didn't think I could, you knew I could. Our bond was unbreakable and will forever live to this day, as I am now a strong black man. As we grow older, things began to change, and she knew she could rely on me. Life did a full circle, even though it seemed strange at first. But just yesterday, I was just in the
room. Hey, y'all.
Hey.
I'm not going to talk a lot. I'm just going to sing this little snippet of a song that my grandpa wrote a long, long time ago. I'm going to the other side. I'm going to the other side. Oh, I made up my mind. Heaven's my choice. I'm going to the other side. I'm going to the other side. I'm going to the other side. Mama made up her mind. Heaven was her choice.
She's gone to the other side. Love you, Mama. Because the Lord is my shepherd, I have everything I need. He lets me rest in the meadow's grass and leads me beside the quiet streams. He's restored my failing health. He helps me do what honors him the most. That's why I'm saved. That's why I'm saved. That's why I'm saved. Saved in his arms. Because the Lord is my shepherd, I have everything I need. He lets me rest in the meadow's grass, and he leads me beside the quiet stream. He restores my failing health, and he lets me do what honors him the most. That's why I'm safe. That's why I'm safe. That's why I'm safe.
Now
I am close. safe in His arms. Oh, I am safe in His arms. Yeah.
Yeah. Yeah.
Yeah.
Thank you.
Can we give the Lord a hand clap of praise in here this afternoon? Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Family, mother, sister, Carol, to the kids, to the rest of this family, to the brothers and sisters in Christ and community who've gathered to celebrate the life of a beautiful woman. I think it's the shared sentiment across the room that none of us would prefer to be here for this today. And as a pastor, there are highs and lows in pastoring, but the fact is these are the hardest moments when you get a chance to meet people and meet their families and share with them, and then you have to bid them see you later. I want to thank the family for the opportunity to share the eulogy today for Sister Debbie. I do apologize for my tardiness at a flight mix up in Dallas, and so I got back here at 3 o'clock, and by the grace of God and no police officers, I was able to make it. I told the man at the airport, whatever you have to do to get me on the flight, I'm not missing this. So if you need to put one person on the airplane, I want to make sure we're here. She is such a beautiful soul. I didn't know she worked at TOA until I got to TOA. And she said, Pastor? I said, Debbie? She said, yeah. She's just such a beautiful soul. Everywhere she went was just a blessing. And so I know the morticians have let me know that we're on a time crunch, so I want to go right into the eulogy. The Word of God says in Proverbs chapter 31, verse 25, strength and honor are her clothing. She shall rejoice in the time to come. Strength, and one translation says dignity, are her clothing. She will laugh at the time to come. If I were to give a title to this eulogy today, I would entitle it, Elevate Your Expectations. Let us pray. Father, we thank you for this time together. Quicken me by your Spirit. Prepare the hearts and minds of your people for the receiving of your word as we celebrate such a beautiful sister. We pray that through her life and the conversation about her life, you will speak to our souls today so that we're better, we're stronger, and we're more prepared to carry out our purpose as she was fully committed to carrying out hers. In Jesus' name, we ask it all, believing it done. And the people of God say it together, amen. If there were one statement that the life of Sister Debbie Mays would speak to all of us, it would be this simple statement. Never put yourself on sale at a discount. Fact is, each life that's placed in this earth, each individual who gets the opportunity to spend time on earth comes with a very distinct and specific purpose. That purpose is lived out, whether it's a short life or a long life, that purpose is lived out so that we who are already here or those of us who arrive after their arrival can see something we could have never seen without them. Had it not been for those souls showing up, each of us showing up, the world would be lacking something. And we're never sent here to be a carbon copy of someone else's existence. We're sent here to be a very uniquely designed, crafted, and created individual. We're placed here so that when people see us, they gain a lesson from God that will make their lives better. Sister Debbie was no different. Her life was more than just about family. It was more than just about being an athlete or a cook or a cosmetologist. or someone who worked at TOA. It was more than just being a mother or a sister. It was about God trying to show us something about life that we could not see without her. And so her life was meant to leave us with lessons, and my goal today is to make sure we don't miss the lessons that God was trying to get us to understand as we say again, farewell and see you later to our dear sister Debbie. To give a framework for this scripturally, I want to go to Proverbs, number 31, Proverbs chapter 31. It's a very interesting Proverbs. We most hear it in any occasion where we're talking about a woman of value. Now, if it's a low value woman, they don't use Proverbs 31, but when it's a high value woman, they normally use it. It's because it's a king's mother telling a king how to choose a wife. Because when you understand your status, you don't just accept anyone. So his mother wants to make sure that he doesn't place himself on sale at a discount. So she begins to say, if you're looking for a wife, this is what you ought to look for in a woman. And she begins to list all of these things. But when she gets around verse 25, or when he gets, depending around verse 25, he says, strength and honor, strength and dignity are her clothing. She will rejoice or laugh at the time to come. If you give me about 10 minutes, I'll be out of your way. I want to just share about this. Because I think that if there's one thing our young women need in this day and time, it's women who are worth modeling after. I know we've got Meg Thee Stallion. I understand you have a lot of people in the public spotlight, but just because you get a spotlight doesn't mean you're worth emulating. And so I love the fact that the Word of God gives us a blueprint. So regardless of what trends or fads come and go, there's a consistency that will always lead a woman to finding her greatest value. And in this, again, he says strength and honor are her clothing. Someone say her clothing. Here's the first principle he teaches us. He teaches us what you ought to wear. He teaches us that a woman of great worth understands that her eternal clothing is always greater than her external clothing. And I want you to understand that there are so many women that take copious amounts of time getting ready to go out of a door. They will manicure their nails. They'll powder their faces. They will go to the best shopping malls to get the best clothing. But I've learned in many cases those same people won't manicure their spirits. I always like to ask the question, is your Bible jealous of your mirror? Because you've spent so much time looking at the physical that you've never taken the time to actually cultivate the spiritual. He says when she gets ready to clean herself up and make herself up, she doesn't start with the outside. She begins with the elements of the internal person. This is what I've learned. A dollar is still worth a dollar even if it's crumbled up. A dollar is still worth a dollar even if it's in a cheap purse. She understands that you can have high quality clothing but have a low quality character if you're not careful. So she teaches us, learn how to cultivate the eternal while you're dressing up the external. So what shall we put on there? She says that he says she has two elements, strength and honor. Someone say strength. Strength is the ability to gauge a level of competency and tenacity and veracity, if you will, that allows you to face, endure, and overcome anything that comes your way. She teaches us that if you're going to have one characteristic in this life, it must be strength. Because the fact is, life is not easy. Life will not always be the way you planned it to happen. Life will not always be without a bend in the road. Life will give you things you expect and give you moments you didn't expect. And if you're not strong, this life will break you down to your lowest common denominator. But I've learned that there's a great joy in having strength. Strength allows you to be able to go through the hardest seasons of your life, not unscathed, but unshaken. Strength will allow you to keep your mind when everything around you is losing theirs and blaming it on you. Strength will allow you to be able to stand when life seems to throw you upside down. Anyone here
don't know that there's a power in having strength. And there are some witnesses here who can testify, the only reason I made it this far is because I cultivated some strength. There's a mother here who can testify, you can't get a baby into this world unless you are willing to exercise some strength. Life isn't for the weakling. It's not for the feeble or the frail. It's for the people who are strong. Is there anybody here who can shout, I've got strength? And even when your strength fails, God specializes in making you strong. That's why Paul said, I can do all things through Christ who gives me strength. That's why Paul said, God has not given us a spirit of fear, but of power, love, and a sound mind. Someone say, get strong. Even in your weakness, Jesus said, my strength is made perfect in weakness. That means your strength is a key attribute to have. Jesus said, strength is her clothing. A woman like this can't survive what she survived unless she was strong. Can I get a witness? Strength and dignity. The actual translation of the word points more to majesty. It means I understand the high value of myself. I understand that I'm not meant to live in low places. I'm not intended to accommodate low standards. And I'm not intended to acquaint with low quality. Dignity means that when I walk into a room, people automatically understand whether or not they can approach me based on their own understanding of how valuable they are. It doesn't demean other people. It just retains a high standard. We choose to understand that life was meant to be lived at high altitudes. And so you refuse to stare a caterpillar when there's a butterfly inside of you. You dignity, regality. She understood that there's a sense of excellence that each person in this room should strive to pursue. Her daughter was talking about when we met earlier this week, how she doesn't really jump. She played, but she didn't jump. And her mom said, jump! Jump! Jump, Chastity! What she was trying to tell her was this: God didn't give you feet to stay on the ground when you're meant to go higher. I need you to understand can I just say so? Just say this for free. Sometimes we get offended because we're committed to low-level holding patterns. And so what happens is we find a space of comfort. And the disruption of excellence always brings the discomfort of comfort. So sometimes the frustration is that I was good where I was. And now a person calls me to a higher level of being. I need you to understand, she teaches us that dignity should be what we wear. Certain people won't call you when you wear dignity. You won't get treated certain ways when you wear dignity. So I want to share this with you because the Bible says strength and dignity, not strength or dignity. Because there's a beauty in being strong and dignified, where not only do I have strength, but I let my strength look majestic. Almost out of time. Let me press on. Because and I'm sharing this with you for this one reason. I want you to hear this. Because so often what happens is we give ourselves a pass in moments where life needs the best of us.
And I have to share that because she was a parent. She could have taken any excuse she wanted to take to raise her kids any way she wanted to raise them. But she refused to give herself a pass when they needed more from her. Are you hearing what I'm saying? And I want to challenge you with that today, my brothers and my sisters, because the fact is, you were not born to be half-baked bread. You were born to give this world your best. As I hurry on, it speaks of her clothing. Then it speaks of her disposition. The Bible says, strength and dignity are her clothes, so she laughs at the time to come. That kind of was interesting to me. Why would a person laugh at what's coming? Two reasons. One, most people get frustrated over forecasts. They worry based on what they perceive to be ahead of them. When you specialize in dignity and strength, you tend to laugh at what's ahead of you, meaning that you tend to treat it with a lighthearted disposition, because you understand that regardless of what's on the forecast, it doesn't matter when you have strength and dignity. What do you mean, preacher? Here's what I mean. When you're committed to being strong and you're committed to being dignified, no circumstance nor experience can catch you any less than that. So whether it's raining or whether it's sunshine, whether it's good days or whether it's bad days, whether it's a moment you anticipated or a moment that caught you off guard, when you're committed to strength, when you're committed to dignity, and people start telling you what's coming, you start laughing, because your condition wasn't meant to be compromised based on your forecast. So the weather does not disrupt your presentation nor purpose. Like a mailman delivering mail in icy conditions, you have a commitment that's deeper than what's going on around you. And so when it comes, you just laugh at it. If I could go a little bit further, if I had like 50 minutes, I would show priestess. But I don't. Only got about 45 seconds to 2 minutes. Y'all mind if I take an extra minute? Thank you, I appreciate it. You're so kind. Another reason she laughs at the time to come is because she understands that the time to come will eventually come to an end. Say it again. The time to come will eventually come to an end. She understood the difference between eternity and time. And that at some point in all of our lives, time will come to an end. And so she laughed at time because she understood that time, the worst thing time could ever give you is the chapter before the last one. One writer said it this way. He says, we do not know what will come, but we know who will come. And if the final chapter belongs to us, then we need not fear the next moment. Okay, they're not feeling me, Jerome. Let me see if I can break it down. So years ago, back in the 90s, that seems like such a long time. Now, back in the 90s, I was a part of the Tennessee State University Aristocrat of Bands, the best band in the land. And so as part of being a part of the Aristocrat of Bands, I played the bass drum. I was on the drum line. So it was a lot of practice throughout the summer and throughout the early fall. We practiced 5 days a week, two or three times a day. And so one day, I'll never forget my first year, I was a freshman, and as a freshman, I came from a different style band. I went to Hillsborough High School in Nashville, Tennessee, which was what they call a core style band. That meant you walked on the field. Tennessee State was what was called a high-stepping band, meaning you marched on the field. So not only that, but we played a different type of music than Tennessee State played. Our music didn't move you. Tennessee State University couldn't keep you from moving it. You know. So we're doing all this practicing. So I pulled one of the older guys aside and I said, man, why are we practicing so hard? we only play 4 15-minute quarters of football. I said, we have more than enough songs for the game. And he looked at me and he said this, I'll never forget, he said, we're not practicing for the game. He says, you don't understand black college band. In black college marching band, the game is just where we go to play temporarily. He said, we are practicing for what they call the fifth quarter. Now, for those who don't know what I mean, in black college band, there's a tradition that after the fourth quarter is over, both bands stay in the stands long after the football teams are gone, and they play band to band, and whoever runs out of songs first is the band who wins. And so they called it the fifth quarter because it was after the fourth quarter was over. So hear what he says. He says, we're not getting ready for the game. We're preparing for the quarter after the game. So the blood, the sweat, and the tears you're shedding are not for this game, but for the time after the game. The workout and the regiments and the music you're memorizing is not for the game. It's for the time after the game. So I just came to tell you, some of y'all wonder, why does she work so hard? Why does she raise her children so intently? She understood that she wasn't doing it for this game. She was doing it for after the game. Why would she come to church every single week? Why not take a couple of weeks off? It's because she wasn't living for this game. She was living for life after this game. Why give your life to Jesus Christ? How do you know he even died? She may not have seen him die, but she believed by faith because she knew that some glad morning this life would be over, and there was another place she was trying to go. That's why the song, that's why Paul said it this way, for we know if this earthen tabernacle shall be dissolved, we have another building, a house of God, not made with hands, eternal in the heaven. Tell your neighbor, say, neighbor, oh neighbor, I'm getting ready for life after this game. Tell a neighbor, when you see me loving my neighbor, when you see me forgiving those who hurt me, when you see me worshiping, it's not for this life, for soon this life will be over. Soon we'll stack up hymn books and Bibles, sticks our sword in the sand of time, and study war no more, because some morning when I close my eyes over here, I lift my eyes in glory, and I want to make sure that when he sees me, he says, come on in, well done, that good and faithful servant. Can we give God glory for the Lord Jesus Christ, who died on a Friday, got up on a Sunday, so that when this life is over, we can walk into glory in the fifth quarter. Hallelujah. Let me say this number. As the morticians come now, elevate your expectation. Don't live an average life when you were born for more than average living. We need you at 110% so that we can become all we're called to become as you become all you're called to become. Can we give some praise for the life of our dear sister? Can we do better than that? Can we give God some praise for the laughter, the memory, the conversation shared, the love given by this sister, Sister Debbie Mays. Thank you. So if we're all, can we all stand? If we can all stand with the exception of the family. The family remains seated.
out all right.
I made it out all right.
I made it out.
I made it out all right.
I made it out all right.